sorry for starting late, but we wanted to make sure a few people make it into the sanctuary with the rain. Shall we open with a word of prayer? Our Father and our God, we give you thanks and praise for bringing us together this evening. We pray, dear Father, that your presence will be felt in our midst, and your Spirit will lead us and guide us and teach us great and mighty things. We commit our brother Jerry into your hands, that, Lord, you will take him and use him as an instrument in your hands in our lives for this week. We thank you, dear Father, for those who are still on the way. We trust that you will bring them here safely. This we pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we stand together and sing hymn number 409? 409 in the white, when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word. I don't have the number in the black, so I think we have enough white for, there are some there, so if you don't have, but it's going to be projected as well. Okay, we don't have an organist, okay. La 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 la. Three, sing. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but a toll he doth quickly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay, for the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet. We will walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm sure we all know why we're here. We're here to interact with our brother, Dr. Jerry White, the author of the book that we have been studying the last 2 years. Dr. White is also the president of the Navigators International, and he has graciously accepted the invitation to be here with us this week. Our prayer is that the Lord will bless him and bless us as he ministers to us. He's going to speak for about 45, 50 minutes, and then we shall take a few questions and answers from the talk from today. He has divided the talks into these 3 days. At the end of each, there will be questions and answers. We have a guide outlined for that. Unfortunately, the wrong one was printed for tonight, so you'll get the right one tomorrow. Number 3 was printed instead of number 1. But it showed there was a little reason to make that mistake, since it's message 1, message 2. And anyway, we are all human. So I'll invite Dr. White to please come up and give him a hand.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Well, good afternoon. You had a nice rainstorm to welcome me and makes me feel right at home, except where I live, it'd probably be a snowstorm. And so it's good to be with you, which I understand we'll get tomorrow. And so by faith, and many of you do not necessarily know my background, but I'm going to share a little bit of my testimony. But before I do that, I have a background in the Air Force and in aerospace engineering. And in my field, there are certain things that are very basic, like mathematics, physics, computer methodology, and you have to learn these first before you can actually operate in the field. And we call those the basics or the fundamentals. So I would like to start with an illustration of the importance of the basics. And this is a video that I'm going to show you of the Air Force Flight Demonstration Team. This is a group of F-16 fighters. They're called the Thunderbirds. And they travel all over the world putting on flight demonstrations, usually they have 6 airplanes, and they'll fly in formation and do all kinds of various maneuvers. Very, very impressive. I've seen them many times. But they have one maneuver that is a solo airplane. Okay, this solo airplane will come in, and I'm going to show you this video, but I'm going to describe it, we're going to watch the video, then we're going to watch it again, because you won't get it, and it's only a minute long. And what happens, the airplane comes in across the front of the audience at 400 miles per hour upside down, and only 50 feet above the ground. He goes flying up in what's called an outside loop, and at the top, he turns over and comes back down again, and he is supposed to come and then fly by the people who are watching, now at about 500 miles per hour. I mean, it's quite a demonstration. And so it's called, if you want to remember the title, an outside loop. So let's go ahead and have the video. Here comes the airplane. Flying upside down. Then he goes straight up. You see how his cockpit is on this side. He goes up to the top. Start coming straight down. Accelerating to about 500 miles an hour.
Knock it off. Thunderbirds, knock it off.
Go, Root.
Thunderbirds, knock it off.
Go, Root.
Go, Root.
One, knock it off. Two, knock it off.
Two, knock it off.
Three, knock it off.
Knock it off.
Did that catch you by surprise? Just a little bit. Now, you probably missed it, but we're going to play it again. And if you watch carefully, just before the plane crashes, you'll see a puff of smoke. Okay, here it comes. So he pulls up.
Left. Continuous left. Fire up.
Upside down now. And he's coming straight down. And then he's leveling off. Now watch for the puff of smoke. Right there.
Bye-bye.
Knock it off. Thunderbirds, knock it off.
Get there. Go, Root.
Thunderbirds, knock it off.
Go, Root. Go, Root. One, knock it off. Two, knock it off. Three, knock it off. Four, knock it off.
Knock it off.
And what they're saying, the leader says, Thunderbirds, knock it off. Thunderbirds, knock it off. So, and somebody got a picture of what happened. And I hope I can, if we can put the slides back up again. There it is. That is a picture of the ejection of the pilot. Now, he is sitting in a seat, and that seat has a rocket engine below it. And that's what that flame is. That's a rocket engine firing out. Up above is the canopy of the cockpit that was thrown off. And here you get a picture of the pilot ejecting. And as he goes up, and then a parachute will deploy, and it will lower him back down to the earth. Now, normally, those kinds of ejection seats aren't meant to be used right next to the ground. So he hit very hard, actually broke his leg, but he lived. Now, what I'd like to demonstrate to you, and when I was flying, and I flew for a year or so in the Air Force, and when you fly a jet, everybody trains in this ejection seat, and you practice over and over and over again on how to do it. Now, today I'm going to teach you how to eject from an airplane. Can I have a chair? Can you bring me that chair? Okay. Now, what they teach you to eject, you're flying in the airplane, and the handle for the ejections are on the side. So they're right on the side. And once you know you're going to eject, you do things. You put feet in, head back, pull. You get it? Okay? Feet in, head back, pull. Now, why do you put your head back so you don't break your neck? Because if you're doing that, there's about 9 times the weight of gravity on this. 9 G's, they call it. Okay, everybody's going to practice. Put your feet on the floor. Okay, we're going to start with the fundamentals. Okay, we're going to go. Feet back, head up, pull. Okay, come on, one more time. You're not fast enough. Okay, feet in, head back, pull. One more time. Feet in, head back, pull. All right? Did you get it?
Yes.
Now, so you practice that again and again and again and again, so that when you have to make the decision to do something, it happens automatically. You don't have to think about it. Let's see, what should I do? 1, 2, 3. No. And now I will ask you a question. How long between the time that he ejected did the airplane crash? You watched it. How long do you think it was? Yeah. It was precisely 0.8 seconds. Think about that. 0.8 seconds. So then what he had to do, he had to observe that the airplane was going to crash. He had to discern that from what he sees outside and he sees on his instruments. And then his mind has to make a decision, and then he has to act. Now, he is trained to be watching everything. Let me tell you what actually happened. It was pilot error, because when he took off, his altimeter was not set to the right pressure. And so when he rolled over at the top of the loop, he thought he was at one altitude, but he was about 500 feet off. And so when he was coming down, the momentum of the airplane was going down. There's no way that he could pull back and actually get it to do differently, because the law of gravity was governing him. So he had to first know how to fly the airplane. Secondly, he had to know how to eject. And thirdly, he had to be able to read the instruments to know when he was in trouble. And so when we discuss ethics and integrity, part of the issue is knowing when you're in trouble and taking action. Now, I'd like to go to the next slide, if we could. If you can put that, okay. Now, here is a picture of the ejection and the first airplane, the Wright Brothers flight, and in about 1907. Now, and I like, when I do this with students, I like to ask them two things. What is the same in the two airplanes, and what is different? Okay, and Norm, we won't do this because I can't hear. You've got your masks on and all that. But when I've done this with students, and they'll guess. Okay, let me tell you what's the same. What is the same is that they both have wings. They both, are we okay? And we both have a pilot. They all have a pilot. It has some kind of an engine. This one on the left is a jet engine. The one on the right has nothing more than just a little bicycle engine. Now that's what's the same. By the way, the aerodynamics are the same for both. Air flowing across the wing and the wing holding it up. Now, what is different? Okay, what is different is the different material, and it's a different kind of engine, and it's a different airflow over the wings. There's a different speed, but the basics are exactly the same. What controls that airplane as a jet is exactly the same as controls the first airplane that ever flew. And the pilot has to understand that. Yes, things change, but the basics remain the same. And what I want to illustrate by this is no matter how much technology, no matter how many videos, no matter how many cell phones, no matter how many automobiles, no matter what medical technology, there are certain basics that we live by. And I hope that during our three sessions together, we'll begin to understand the basics. Now, I thought it would be helpful just to give you a little background of my own life and my own testimony. So if we can have the video, slides back again, and I assume I can probably control them. This is where I was born, a little town in the middle of the United States, great farm country. It was called Garden City, and it had 100 people. Those are my two granddaughters, by the way. And right under the N, that house is the house that I was born in. And this is my mother. She was 17 when I was born. And that's her holding me. Now, a disaster happened in my mother's life at this time. And that is my father left her and left me and divorced her. And so she was, you can imagine what that was like for a young woman to be in a little town like that. Everybody talked about it. Everybody, I'm sure, made fun of her. Now, for me, it wasn't a problem. because I was just an infant. And if you, as you look at these things, you, there is my mother holding me as a baby. If you look at her eyes are sad. One of the few pictures I have of her like this, because her life essentially has been destroyed. And she's left with one thing, me, as a baby. But then disaster happened to me. My mother remarried when I was 8 years old. And then we left this small town of 100 people and traveled almost 3,000 kilometers away to a city of 180,000. And I was one shook up kid. I mean, here I was going with a man that I, a father that I really didn't know. He was stuck with a rather spoiled young man because I had a wonderful childhood being raised by my mother and my grandfather. But God had a special plan. And so when we came to, we'll need the next slide. I mean, that's me at age 2 and age 7. Let's go on to the next one. This is, when I got to this town, Spokane, Washington, this man on the right, his name is Walt Nelson. We came back from a going out to a lake one day, and I had been listening to a Sunday school class taught by another man for almost 3 years. I was 11 years old, and he asked if any of us would like to receive Jesus. And I said, I would. By the way, do you know which one is me? It's the middle of the boys with the blonde hair. That's me. And so Walt led me to Christ, and I knew exactly what I had done. And I went into our home and told my parents that I'd made this decision. They were not believers. And I'm sure they thought it was fine, it'll go away, don't worry about it, it's just a little phase in his life. If you remember when you came to faith, who you had to tell. But then the man who really influenced me, I don't have his picture on this one, he mentored me, he discipled me. I worked in his business. He taught me how to live. He taught me how to handle finances. And when I went to the university, which was 500 kilometers away, it was not my parents who drove me. It was this man, Bob Shepler. And he drove me and told me where to live, and that's where I met the Navigators when I was at the University of Washington. And they began to disciple me. Navigators, by the way, don't disciple anybody. People disciple people. And if any of you know the 2-7 series in church discipleship, the man who created that was my college roommate. And he began to meet with me every day, and we would have a quiet time together. He taught me how to read the Bible, how to study it, how to pray. And he influenced my life. And it was there that I met my wife, Mary. And we were married very young. We were married, let me go back to that. Let's go back one. There we are. There we're on our honeymoon. And we were married before our senior year at university. And so I finished university, got a degree in electrical engineering, and immediately, because we had a universal draft in the United States at that time, everybody had to serve in the military. So I trained to be an officer and having a college degree, I was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the Air Force and went to fly. Spent a year flying, and unbeknownst to me, they had to get rid of quite a few pilots because it was an overage of pilots. And I had a check ride one day, and I failed. At least he said I failed. He said, well, you can fly it okay, but I don't think you're going to be able to fly it as well as you need to. And I was out of pilot training. And so I thought, wait a minute. God has led me into the Air Force, and if you're in the Air Force, you fly airplanes. So I just simply told the Air Force, I said, okay, fine. send me to an engineering job somewhere, and then I'll just get out of the Air Force and go back and work for Boeing Aircraft Company, where I had a job waiting for me. But instead, the Air Force sent me to a place called Cape Canaveral. And I think I have a, well, let's see that. That's on the, I'm going to go next to it. At Cape Canaveral, this is Billy Graham, and I became a mission controller at Cape Canaveral. And let's see if we can get a better slide of this working. Advance it one, if you would. Yeah, there we are. There is central control at Cape Canaveral. And if you've ever seen a movie of us on space, that's exactly what it looked like. And so I was one of those men sitting down far toward the left in the particular job that I had. And so God led me into America's early space program. And then God spoke to me and said, you should not get out of the Air Force, but you should stay in the Air Force, go get a master's degree, and then go teach at the Air Force Academy. And the Air Force Academy happens to be located in Colorado Springs, where the Navigator headquarters are. So I thought, that's good. You know, God can lead me. I'll go to the Air Force Academy. I'll teach astronautics. I will then disciple and evangelize students, and I'll get training from the Navigators. And so we did. There we are at the United States Air Force. How do you like Mary's glasses and her red hair? She is a bright redhead. And there is when we have three of our children. And so God blessed us at that time at the Air Force Academy, and we saw hundreds of young men come to Christ. But I thought I was going to just stay there and continue teaching, but then the department head said, we want you to go get a PhD. And I had no interest whatsoever in getting a PhD, and I was absolutely afraid of it because they would only give me 2 years to do it, and it's nearly impossible. But God led us to go and get a PhD and then come back to the Air Force Academy to teach and then to continue ministering there with the Navigators. So God gave me many opportunities. But I'll fast forward on this. This is a picture of me when I'm a young lieutenant and my first child, Steve, as a year and a half or two-year-old. And then this is Steve as an adult. Now the reason I want to tell you, I show that to you, and I'm going to stop my testimony here, but later on I left the Air Force, went full-time with the Navigators, and later in God's sovereignty, he made me president of the Navigators. But at the same time, I had stayed in the Air Force Reserve, and I was promoted to general in the Air Force. So here is life. It's pretty successful. You're president of the Navigators. You're a general in the Air Force. You have a PhD. But then I got a call one day when I was speaking at a conference telling me that my son had been murdered. And he had driven a taxi. He had graduated from university. He was working at a radio station, and he had his own program between midnight and 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, when you're breaking into something. And then he was to put bread on the table. He was driving his own taxi. And somebody had made a decision that they were going to kill somebody, an innocent person. He later said that God has been unfair to me, and I'm going to get back against God by killing an innocent person. And so he called for a taxi, and he had committed that whoever picked him up, he was going to murder. And that's what happened to my son. That changed our lives forever. It made all the successes absolutely worth nothing. And it caused us to examine our beliefs. Do I believe in the sovereignty of God? Do I really think that God is in control of this world? Or is it just all a matter of chance and as random. So that's a very brief testimony that I wanted to share, because it had the major elements: my mother's divorce, a new stepfather in moving, a businessman who helped me come to Christ, then a university where someone from the Navigators began to disciple me, going into the Air Force thinking I was going to be a pilot, God totally changing my direction, getting involved in the America Space Program, and then when I thought I was going to stay in for a career in the Air Force, the president of the Navigators, Lauren Sanney, asked if I would come full-time with the Navigators. So we went full-time at age 35 with four children. And so, and then, as God would have it, later becoming president of the Navigators, and then this happens to my son. Okay. So that's a testimony. And in our question and answer time, I'm very happy to answer questions, or we can do it tomorrow if you want to ask questions about this. So, we've learned two things so far. We've learned about the basics. But now we're going to launch onto the next set of slides, if you would. And we're going to begin discussing the book, Honesty, Morality, and Conscience, which some of you have seen and have studied here. But I'd like to give you a little of what we're going to actually do in these three sessions. First of all, I'm going to talk today about integrity. And some thoughts on just how God works in our life and just how he works in the world. Then tomorrow I'm going to speak on the place of conscience, the strange things that tells you when you're right or when you're wrong. And then the third session will be on the issue of sexual morality. So that's the outline of what we're going to do. Today's session is fairly heavy, and it's fairly fast, so we're going to go ahead and begin this session, if we can start. There it is, leadership and integrity. And the first thing we're going to share after the testimony, and I shared what we're going to do on all of those. By the way, we'll talk about how to teach integrity in your home. So, we would like to go now to the scriptures, to Mark chapter 12 and verses 13 through 17. Now in Mark chapter 12, Jesus is wandering around preaching in the little villages. But you know who was following him? He was being followed by a bunch of Pharisees. And so, here is the text of this, and it's up there. Later, they sent some of the Pharisees and Herodians to Jesus to catch him in his words. And they came to him and said, "Teacher, we know that you are a man of integrity." Now, hold on to that phrase. "And you aren't swayed by men, because you know..." That will go on to the next slide. "You aren't swayed by men because you pay no attention to who they are, but you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. So, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar? Should we pay?" And I'll read the rest of the passage. It isn't on the screen. He said, "Should we pay taxes or shouldn't we?" Then it says, "But Jesus knew their hypocrisy." He says, "Why are you trying to trap me?" So he confronted him. And then he said, "Bring me a denarius, a coin." And he says, they brought them the coin and he said, "Whose portrait is on the coin?" And they said, "Well, it's Caesar's." And he said to them, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar, and to God what is God's." And they were amazed at him. He did not fall into his trip. Now you have to remember that they were trying to kill Jesus. And at the age of 12, he confounded the scholars. And at age 30, he began demonstrating his power by miracles and his wisdom. And so here they came. But see, Jesus, though he was an enemy to the leaders, he was a hero to the common men, because he gave them hope and he gave them purpose and he gave them the promise of eternal life. So now we come, how did they define integrity? Did you notice it? The first thing was that you aren't swayed by man's opinion. Okay, that's good. See, they had a good definition. The second thing was you're not partial. You're not partial to anyone, and that you teach truth. That is, there is no compromise. So that was really quite good. The Pharisees really had it right. They saw Jesus as a man of integrity. And then, of course, they set the trap on taxes. So if he said no, they could accuse him of what? Of rebellion against Caesar, right? And if he said yes, then he compromises his devotion to God. So he looked at the coin and he said, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. So, how do we define integrity? Now, if I were in a smaller group, I'd have you shout out the things, but we're not in a small group. So let me just go through it. Honesty, virtue, honor, morality, principle, upright, righteous, godliness, wholeness, and sincerity. You see, those are synonyms, aren't they, for integrity? If I were to ask you to write down a definition of integrity, you'd come up with many of those words. Now, I'd like to mention something about this integrity, and here it is, and that is that no one becomes a liar, a thief, and a cheat in one sudden moment, but rather in a series of innocuous actions, seemingly minor choices make up the big ethical issues easy, or not so easy. So, in other words, we dig our ethical grave not with a big ditch digger, a machine, but we do it with a teaspoon, one little bit at a time. So, wrong moral decisions made over a long period of time, a small plagiarism or minor cheating, a few stolen items, of a few small white lies, the giving of a wrong impression, which lies without being specific. Every decision counts. And so I would like to propose that life is made up of many small ethical decisions, and they either make the big wrong choices easy, or they prevent those choices that destroy our lives. And what I like to say is that the first moral suicide occurs when I no longer feel badly about when I violate ethical or moral principles, and when I rationalize that there are no absolutes that we live by. So that's a basis for there. Now, a key verse that comes to my mind is Acts 24:16. And herein do I strive to have a conscience void of offense toward God and toward man. So what are the elements now of character? The first is the love of God and of people. The second is thinking well and speaking well of other people. You can see that in Philippians 2. I won't take time to read it now. And that we are not easily offended. That is, I've been in many situations where people don't like what I'm doing. I'm in one right now in a particular friend said to me, Jerry, just don't get your ego tied up with it. If they reject what you're proposing, that's fine. But you've done your work, and we'll see what happens. So we're not easily offended, and that we're kind to people, and that we, that our life thoughts and our sexual urges are under control. But we'll talk about that more in the third sessions. Now, what are our basic goals? Here's the goal. You say, okay, what do I want you to get out of these sessions? And that is that you and I become men and women of integrity. And that secondly, we want to influence our children and those for whom we are responsible to live with integrity. And for that, I refer to the, and then we want to influence our peers and our leaders to live and intact and act with integrity. You see the three? Ourselves, our family, and the people that we work with. That they say, that's a person whom I can trust. Now, we might want to ask why people live, act, and act honestly. First of all, some do it because that's a law. In other words, it's that I shouldn't speed or I shouldn't steal or whatever. So we have the law. The second thing we have is they do it out of fear. If I get caught, something bad is going to happen to me. And thirdly, that we do it, we'll get it here, out of inner conviction. And what we want is to have inner convictions in our lives. So, as we pursue this now, you say, where do convictions actually come from? Okay? And I'd love to have a small group. I'd have you shout out where convictions come out. The problem is, if you shout out, I can't hear you because of your masks and probably because of the accent. So, they come from your family background. You know, the way you're raised, your father or your mother says, don't do that. And you say, why? Well, you're not supposed to steal. Don't hit your brother like that. You know, don't speak like that to your grandfather. Do you see what I mean? They start teaching you things. Your family background is very important. So if you come from a background where there are more immoral choices, that will influence you too. Then the second is experience. Through the years, you have been developed by experience, by your peers, by your education. You go and you're in a classroom, and a teacher says, here's what's right, and here's what's wrong. You shouldn't cheat. You shouldn't steal things. And so we are taught from age 5 or 4 onward when we're in school. Supposedly the teachers teach us. And then there is your spiritual and religious foundations. And they become very, very important. So what are the types of integrity? One is a personal integrity. How do I live my life on a personal basis? The second is professional integrity. How I live my work and what I do externally, the way I do my job. If I'm a government employee, am I teaching what is right? Am I treating people right, or am I taking a bribe? And thirdly, those two things must be connected. They cannot be by themselves by any means. So the definition of integrity is an issue of the heart, our motive, the issue of our examples, our actions, that is the example, and then there's the issue of other people's perception, whether they think of you as a person of integrity. So the focus of our integrity, first, is with God. The second is with your family, and the third is with your leaders and those around you. So that's how we focus our integrity. Then with your followers, if you are a leader. Now, the currency of integrity, what is currency? If you pick out currency, that is, you take out a bill and you pay something with currency, right? Okay, so how do you purchase integrity? What is the currency of integrity? And the first is your word. And you are you a man or woman of the word, your word? What you say, if you say, I will do it, will you do it? If you promise something, will you keep that promise? And if you ever remember with your kids, they're growing up, and then you say you can't do them, but Dad, you said I could. Did you see what I mean? If they feel you have gone back on your promise, that's your word. The second is the way you live. People watch you. They watch how you work. They watch how you talk. They watch how you act toward your husband or toward your wife. They watch how you take care of your children. They watch just your life the way it is. And the third is your faithfulness and your dependability. That is, are you a faithful and dependable person? And then your motives. Now, nobody else knows that but you. You're the only one that knows your motives. Because it's inside. And that's what we'll talk about a little tomorrow with on the issue of our conscience. But what is the foundation of integrity is the basic convictions by which you live. The basic convictions by which you live. And I apologize for doing this a little fast. I know you can't write down all of this. You'll be able to fill it in a bit with the handout tomorrow. So the core issues of integrity are these. And a friend of mine by the name of Walt Henriksen, as all people in all ages believe that truth is absolute, so too they agree with the golden rule. The golden rule is the foundation of morality. The practice presence of conscience implies the ability to distinguish between right and wrong, and the gauge used by each individual to determine right and wrong is how they themselves wish to be treated. That's the golden rule. Okay, everybody, just about everybody knows what it means to be honest. Everybody knows what it means to tell the truth. Now, your culture may go against that, and so your culture may teach you to lie. But everybody knows that it's wrong. And then the inner gauge of this integrity is our conscience. It's that feeling inside. When you do something wrong, you look at pornography, or you treat your wife badly, or you can just name it, and your conscience says, that's wrong. So the conscience. The voice of integrity, that is what people see, is our work, how we work. The spirit of integrity is how we treat people. And the reputation of integrity is the credibility and the trust that is out there. Does that make sense to you? See what I mean? The inner part, how we work, then how we treat people, how I treat you. And then finally, our reputation. And by the way, everybody has a reputation. Well, I know them, and they always lie. Or I know them, and they're a kind person. Or I know them, and, you know, you can't trust them. See, everybody builds a reputation. And once you have a reputation, it's very difficult to change that reputation. Now, so what must we do? First of all, I think we have to make a basic decision. And that decision is to do what is right, to have a good conscience. So those two things. So if you work on just two, that's pretty simple. I'm going to do what is right. I want to have a good conscience. So what now is the biblical basis for ethical living? And I have three rules. It's a rule of faith. I'm going to do this and trust God that he'll make it right. So if your culture says you do it and cheat or bribe or whatever, and you say, I have to give in to it, but you decide to do a different thing, you do it by faith. The second thing is we do it. I'm going to come down here, hopefully. The rule of law. That is, we do it because it's legal or it's illegal. Now, just because something is legal doesn't mean it's right. And some things that are illegal may be wrong things. In other words, the law is not right. So the law has to come under a different law, the law of God. And the final thing is the great commandments. What is the great commandment? Love the Lord your God, what? With all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And the second is like unto it, you shall what? Love your neighbor as yourself. That is the great, those are the three laws that we can live by. So what must we do? Proposition one that I'd like to give to you is every ethical and moral decision of life is governed by the three principles of faith, dependence on God, law, the moral fences that are around us. For instance, one law would be that I should not have sex outside of marriage. Or you can just, that's a law, and that's important. Or you should say, I shouldn't steal, or I shouldn't cheat. And the third is to love, which is the higher motive. There is a higher motive that we ask for God to help us by. So propositions two and three. So proposition one is that moral ethic. Proposition two is the application of these three principles depends on the personal experience of being broken by God and a surrender to his lordship. Men and women, if you are not a follower of Jesus Christ, it's almost impossible to live a life of integrity. Now, I want to say, I have known many non-believers who are men and women of integrity. And you have too. There are people out there who do not know Jesus, but the power to live a life of integrity comes by knowing Jesus Christ. The second proposition is the only source for living an ethical life is power from Christ himself, which is fueled by your daily time with God and a life of daily obedience. By the way, that's the basics. So every time you think of, why do I have a quiet time? Why do I read the scriptures? Why do I study the scriptures? Why do I apply them to my life? Just think of sitting in that chair and pulling those. You practice it over and over again. It's something you do every day. It's something you try to build into your life as a habit. And that's why I say that's where the power comes to live a life of integrity. And of course, everything must be connected. Better is a poor man whose walk is blameless than a rich man whose ways are perverse. And here is how I'd like to describe this. There are three aspects. It's what you know, what you are, and what you do. Now, all you have to write on your notes is just those three circles. So we need to know what is right. It needs to be part of our character. And then it needs to be applied by what we do. So the know is our leadership skills, our competence. personal character. The do is goals, vision, and a process. And I made that slide primarily for teaching leadership. But the result of all of that is it builds trust. Integrity builds trust. So, that is the last thing that I want to share today. And admittedly, I've gone quite fast, and but we want to keep within the time, and we would like for you to get home with a proper curfew. And so I trust that this introduction to integrity will be helpful to you, because it gives you a framework of thinking. Remember law, fair, and love? And remember the ethics that we have shared on know, be, and do? All of those are together. So the next two sessions, we will work on the issue of conscience. Where does the conscience fit? And finally, we'll work on some of the areas specifically of sexual morality. What I'd like you to remember from today, there aren't many. You'll always remember that video, won't you? And you'll remember the practice that it took that man to eject. But he had a lot of training before he did that. The training allowed him to sense when something was wrong. And much of being a pilot is being able to sense what's going on around you. And much of living life is to sense what is right and wrong. And then by practice, he had learned to do the right thing. Why I showed that video. For the basics and the background. So God bless you. We'll take some time for some questions. I think I got it within the 50 minutes that it was allotted. And so, Jerry, if we want to have some questions, I'm happy to respond to them.
There's a key here for maybe it's your house.
Oh, I'll take it. Thank you. Oh, no. Well, that wouldn't be integrity.
Please make sure you collect it. The outlines are ready. You pick one per couple or per person, one per family. As you go out, they will have them ready for you at the gates. The notes for today. And secondly, if we don't take all the questions today, we'll take them tomorrow. We're planning to leave here at 20 minutes after 5. Okay? So we can take a few questions now, and then by 20 minutes after 5, we'll be out of this place. Okay. We asked if there are questions earlier on that you could write and send. None has come up here. So are there any questions? Or rather, what questions do you have? dun, 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 dun. Going. It's either he did not communicate well or he communicated so well that you do not have any questions. Or we are in a hurry to go home so that we don't get caught up. Okay. Okay.
Now, Jerry, does the environment we live in affect our ability to maintain integrity? That is the kind of society we live in. Does it affect our integrity? If I want to maintain personal integrity, does my surrounding, my environment affect me in any way?
Does that get out to everybody who's
yes,
listening? Okay. First of all of us live in a society, and the society is never perfect. And so the society can form some of the things that we should do. But if they're wrong, we have to resist it. And then some societies will not allow us to do the things which we ought to do. everybody inside their society has to decide how to live. For instance, you might live in a society that says you can never talk about Jesus anywhere. But what does that mean? Does that mean if somebody asks you about Jesus, can I talk about it? I would say yes. But we have to do it wisely. We have to do it carefully. So, and you remember Peter says, when he was captured, says, don't speak into the name of Jesus anymore. He says, I must do what God says and not what man says. So there are times when we have to counter the society. And that takes great risk. It is not the best. It's not easy. There are times when we may be persecuted for doing what is right. And so I wish I could give you specifics, but I don't live in your society. And I know there are cultural issues that probably, or legal issues, that constrain you. And that's where direction from God and our conscience will give us guidance what to do. Let's remember that 11 of the 12 disciples were martyred. The only one who was not martyred was John, who wrote Revelation. So they paid a price. Fortunately, in most places around the world, we can live a Christian life without heavy persecution. Now, if you come from a background where people hate Christianity, perhaps, then you may be persecuted. But we have to do what we do with wisdom, Zach. For instance, when I was teaching at the Air Force Academy, I was not allowed to share my testimony in my classroom. Now, I did one time, but I did it very, very carefully. But let me tell you, everyone knew I was a believer. And so when they would ask me, then I could respond to them. So at least that's a start, okay?
One of the elements of character, you said, is to think and speak well of people. But when you have terrible bosses who are not people of integrity, I think sometimes I find it difficult not to think negatively of them. So how do I overcome that, please?
Okay, if I understand it, how can I speak well of people when I can't say anything good about them? For one thing, maybe you should say nothing. They say that the Lord gave us one mouth and two ears, so listen and just not say. I have many times said some very stupid things, and I regret it. And so be very careful. Try and be wise. Try not to tear down anybody's character, in public especially. Now, we may have to speak.
Yes. The two questions asked, sir, I think they are too narrow for my liking. Too narrow in the sense that we are living in a political era, talking about democracy all over the place. And we know that politics is a game, and the game always has rules. And the rules of politics, strictly speaking, are not palatable at all. Now, what is the role of a Christian in a political era or dispensation? Thank you. Let me just
please repeat that. Help me know what he said. I couldn't understand.
What is the role of a politician in a political era as a Christian?
Yeah. Okay. I've known many Christian politicians. We have one man, his name was Bill Armstrong, who was a senator. And he was a man of incredible integrity. And so the politician, when Bill Armstrong died, the state senate in my state started chanting, Jesus, 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 because that's what he was known for. And he was
truth, doing what is right, and not doing what is wrong. In other words, not taking bribes, not taking advantage of his position. But I really believe that God calls some people into politics. And if he does, he will give that person the ability to live and gain respect. They may not be liked always, but I believe they will gain respect. At least that's what I've observed. Okay? All right? Thank you. All right?
Okay. Copies have been made. They are not going to go around, but we'll try your integrity. Take one per person. I'm correcting what I was told earlier. It's one per person because you get one tomorrow. If you get one today, don't take another one tomorrow. Okay? Integrity. Begin to put that into practice. As many as can get one today, please take one. And tomorrow, if you don't get one today, you'll be given one. Okay? And then that of tomorrow will also come. We'll try and make sure that everybody gets that early. Okay? We are going to close in prayer. One announcement? If you have room in your car to take someone in your visit, you know, times are hard, so please make sure you are your neighbor's keeper. Let's allow to close us in prayer.
If it belongs to you and the pen, maybe you are not able to use it today, please pick it immediately after we finish. Heavenly Father, we thank you this evening for your word and for reminding us of some things that are very important as we are called the light of the world. Father, we pray that as we go home today, that your word will remain with us, that it will keep coming into our minds, it will keep coming into our heart. Even when we sleep, Father, we pray that we will remember the ambassadors of Jesus Christ, and that we are supposed to influence other people by our lives. They will know that we are your children by our lives. We pray, dear Lord, that you will keep your children safe, even as we go home now. Lord, you know the environment from where each of us have come from, but we trust in you that you will not allow any evil to befall any of us. And tomorrow, Lord, we pray that we will all be able to come, even other people who will hear about it tomorrow. We ask their Lord that we give them the very essence of coming here, that they will be able to come and join us in learning from your feet. Blessed Redeemer, we thank you for your faithfulness. We pray that your grace, your love, your power will overshadow us from now and forevermore in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace. The Lord